may be seated. This time I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as we receive this morning's tithes and offerings. Welcome back. I'm glad you're here. Did great. Joyce did a good job in your stead, though. You were missed, though. Let us pray this morning. Lord, thank you for all that we have received. Lord, thank you for your continued faithfulness. And Lord, may we be faithful in return. Lord, you bless us beyond imagination. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. This past Wednesday, we did watch the first episode of The Chosen, and it was a good time, and then we went over to our place and hung out in the yard and enjoyed the time of fellowship. And so we won't be doing that this week because we're out of town, but coming back the following week on the 19th, we will watch episode 2 and hang out at the house for a bit afterwards as well. So I would encourage you to do that. And if you need to catch up, if you've never watched any of it, go watch the first 2 seasons. And then we can be with us for season 3 that we'll be watching throughout the summer. So it's an awesome time together. A couple of prayer requests that I would like to bring to your attention as we move into our family altar time. One of those is in my family. My father-in-law last week, I don't know if I mentioned it or not, had a heart attack after surgery. He's doing well. They went in, put a stent in, found out he had a 90% blockage in one of his arteries. And there's blockages in others, so he goes back this week to have another stent put in. And so just be praying for my father-in-law, Leroy, and my mother-in-law. And also, Alicia, it's a little bit hard being quite a ways away and experiencing those kind of things. So she's got some siblings a little bit closer, trying to process and deal with all that comes with that. So if you'll remember them. And then Janine's daughter, Jill, spent some time in the hospital this weekend and just has some real medical needs going on. And some of those are roadblocks with financial things, with the care that's needed. And so making an appeal to the ministry and different things to try to get some things covered that aren't at the moment. And if you've ever worked in that area, you know that's an uphill battle. So also check your bulletin, check the prayer chain. Let's remember all those things. And so find a posture of prayer this morning. If that's coming to the altars and kneeling, it's a great place to encounter the Lord, or sitting, standing, wherever you may be, if you'll bow your heads with me. Lord, thank you for the quietness. That in these moments of stillness, as we talked about last week, we can hear you, we can feel your presence. And so, Lord, this morning as we take a few moments to put petitions before you, to put confessions before you, to give you thanksgiving, hear us this morning, Lord, as we seek to hear you. Lord, there's a number in our community, in our faith community, our own families, who are dealing with conflict and strife, and Lord, that can be overwhelming. It can be scary. And sometimes those fears just overwhelm us. And so, Lord, I pray this morning that in all those situations, that your mighty presence will be felt, and Lord, we will be overcomers, not because of anything we do, but because of our humbleness before you and your spirit and your mightiness working through us. Lord, there's a number of health issues. Lord, it seems perpetual. These frail bodies give up on us sometimes. But Lord, we trust that you are a good God who desires to see us made whole. And so Lord, touch all those health needs that are coming to our minds. We lift all those up to you. I think of Leroy and Jill. Lord, and I pray for all those who are in care homes or homebound, and Lord, that your presence will draw near to them today. Thank you that you are a great big God who is not confined to this place and this body, but that you are a God who radiates around the world. Lord, we've got some church business coming up this week. As 75 people head towards White Horse and gather to one, celebrate the things that you've done across BC and the Yukon in the Church of the Nazarene, but also looking ahead to this next year and voting on leadership and talking about the good things that are in store. Lord, be with those who are traveling. And may you be glorified in all the work that we do. And Lord, may I just express gratitude and thanksgiving for summertime. The joys of the sun shining and the outdoor time. And Lord, may we be grateful for this wonderful creation that you've blessed us with. And Lord, may we continue and pursue to be faithful stewards of it. Lord, thank you for this time together. As we open up your word, will you speak to us? Reveal truth to us? Move in our hearts? Lord, we pray all these things in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to continue on in our summer movie series. It's technically week two, but I cheated and showed one extra one, so it's week three. And this week, we're going to go to a bit of an unusual movie. Chuck kind of laughed at me when I told him we was going to do this one. The lead actor is not his favorite actor. The movie is Liar Liar. It's fair enough. I figured he was a Canadian hero. Liar Liar is a movie that, you know, back in the 90s came out, and there's a lot of humorous things in it, but if you look at the main character, he is just not a good dude. Like, truly not. Like, there's just, I mean, he's a lawyer after all. That's an easy one. That was just low-hanging fruit. But he's just got this thing about him. His work, his career, all his drive is for money and status and things, and to the detriment of his relationships. He's already divorced. His kid is suffering. And so we were actually going to watch two clips. They're not very long, but this first clip is the detriment that this is happening to his child. And so let's see what the effect is.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Max. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, boy. Make a wish. Come on, Max. It can be anything you want, anything in the whole world.
Max, your father is sorry. He had to work.
He said he was gonna be here, he promised.
I know, but he promises that he's going to see you tomorrow, okay? He's going to pick you up from school, all right? So come on, make a wish.
Mm-hmm.
that for only one day, Dad couldn't tell a lie.
Simple as that. Young man wishing that his dad cannot tell a lie. As Christians, this is something we learn young. Actually, even as children, whether you're in the Christian faith or not, you learn lying is not a good thing. But our scriptures tell us that to lie is a sin. And Jesus goes into even greater depth of what does it look like when we say something. And so this morning, if you'll turn to Matthew 5:33, this is a small portion of the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus is clarifying what it means to talk about our speech and our language when we talk to one another. Picking up at verse 33, it says, "Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord.' But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one." You guys probably heard this more than once. Let your yes be yes or your no be no. Jesus is simply saying to these people, whatever you say, you do. It's action. So we can say lots of things. But if it's not followed up with actions, we become a liar. Jesus doesn't desire for us to do that. He says, when you speak, make it true. And the only way we can make it true is through our actions. And this young man, his dad has done nothing but break promise after promise. I'm a parent. My children ask for things a lot. And I end up using that word maybe. Maybe we'll do that, because that gives me an out, right? I never said yes, but I didn't say no. And so I've had to work hard to kind of go, no, this is where we're at. And it's hard to do sometimes. Because you know what? Sometimes I say yes to things with my kids that I'm like, ugh, man, I got to follow that up. I got to follow through with playing that game that is not my favorite. And that's kind of a silly example, but when we talk about our witness, if we don't become a person of integrity who's reliable in saying what we say and meaning what we say and doing what we say, then anything we do or say becomes worthless. Now, Max's wish comes true. It's fantastical. This thing that he desired, that his dad not be able to tell a lie for one whole day, comes true. Well, his dad is a lawyer, has a big case, and in order to win his case, he needs to tell an untruth. He needs to lie. So he finds out that he's not able to tell the truth or tell an untruth. And so what does his dad do? He comes back and he says, "Hey, Max, found out about this. I need you to do something for me." So we're going to watch one more clip and we're going to see what his dad asks of Max.
Monster Max!
Godzilla, you can't play catch?
I'd like to, but I can't right now. Max, I got to talk to you. Your mommy told me about that wish you made last night. It came true, Max.
Really? You mean you have to tell the truth?
Yes.
No matter what?
No matter what?
Is wrestling real?
In the Olympics, yes. On Channel 23, no.
Will sitting too close to the TV set make me go blind?
Not in a million years.
If I keep making this face, will it get stuck that way?
Uh-uh. In fact, some people make a good living that way. Now listen, Max, you gotta do something for me. I need you to take back that wish.
So you can lie?
Yes, but not to you. You see, Max, sometimes grown-ups need to lie. It's hard to explain, but if... Look, here's a good example. When your mommy was pregnant with you, she gained a good 40 pounds. There was nothing she wouldn't eat, and Daddy was scared. But when she'd ask me, how do I look, I'd say, honey, you look great. You're beautiful. You're glowing. If I'd have told mommy she looked like a cow, it would have hurt her feelings. Understand?
My teacher tells me real beauty's on the inside.
That's just something ugly people say. Max, no one can survive in the adult world if they have to stick to the truth. I could lose my case, I could lose my promotion, I could even lose my job. Now I need your help, Max, okay? Okay, now do whatever you did last night, only this time, make it an unwish.
I did it.
Excellent! Yeah, I just need a little test.
Did it work?
Not like I'd hoped. Did you unwish it?
Yesterday, when I wished it, I really meant it. This time, when I unwished it, I only did it because you told me to.
All right. Now do it again, and this time, lean in.
But I can't.
Why not?
Because I don't want you to lie.
I explained this. I have to lie. Everybody lies. Mommy lies. Even the wonderful Jerry lies.
But you're the only one that makes me feel bad.
Uh-oh. Did you guys hear that last line? You're the only one that makes me feel bad. Kids have a way of humbling us. So more than just telling the truth and letting yes be yes and no be no, Miss Sherry mentioned it, this thing inside of our mouths can get us into trouble. Has your tongue ever gotten you into trouble? Have you ever said a cutting word, an unkind word, an untrue word? If you will, turn to James chapter 3. The tongue is amazing, but it's also a little bit scary. I have a cousin in Waxahachie, Texas, who, to use the phrase, she has to put her foot in her mouth a lot. This woman is bubbly and outgoing and fun and truly means nothing by it, but sometimes the tongue goes loose before the brain catches up and goes, let's not. For example, her children attended a small Christian school in the town outside of theirs, and the principal, her husband, was a police chief. And he was on a call at one point and ended up being shot and was paralyzed from the waist down. And he was in rehab and working on things, and he made this remarkable recovery. He was still paralyzed, but, you know, things were improving. He was able to go and speak and do some motivational speaking and things like that. And my cousin walked up to his wife and was just talking to him and going, wow, you know, your husband, he's just a walking miracle. Can you imagine saying that to a paralyzed individual who is wheelchair bound? The woman took it in stride and went, well, he doesn't walk, and so he's a rolling miracle. But her tongue would often get her in trouble because, well, it just would go all over the place. And James recognizes that this small insignificant thing in proportion to our body can do a lot of damage. So let's read a few verses in James chapter 3. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, For you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever they will, the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. Let's keep going. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. I don't think James looks very fondly at the tongue. And I think he's right in being skeptical of what this thing can do. Because think back to your younger years, and we used to make comments like, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Wow, talk about a lie. I mean, sticks and stones will break your bones, but man, if you think back to your childhood, what's the thing that sticks with you? Words. It's amazing what words will do. The words have this power to destroy. And you look at this movie and you think, oh, it's silly fun. And you look at this little boy and he makes that comment to his dad, but you're the only one who hurts me. And man, as a dad, that I have to evaluate that. My youngest is Tucker's going to kind of a summer reading program for a couple weeks. I go Friday to pick him up, and he's kind of standing off to the side, and he walks up to me and he goes, hey, the teacher wants to talk to you. Well, I'd actually talked to the teacher the day before, didn't think anything of it, but normally that's not a great sign. With Tucker, it usually is. Good kid. But I walk up and she goes, hey, we've had some hands-on things that escalated today to one of our friends being hurt. Tucker had used his hand as a weapon against another child. Very uncharacteristic of him. And in that moment, I'm thinking, son, what are you doing? That's not who you are. This is not what you do. And in me, I'm keeping a cool face for the teacher, but there's this bubbling going, no, this is not right. There's an injustice. Son, you cannot do this. And I'm feeling angry. And we walk back to the car, and I hadn't said anything. But as the Lord has worked on me over the years, and this is where James is getting at, that we have to work with the Lord and mature in the way that we talk about and to other people. God's creation, the ones who's been, and that includes my own children. Because in my younger years, I would have raised my voice, I would have been angry, and I would have told him. Instead, I was able to find some peace in myself and go, son, what are you doing? I didn't raise my voice. We had a conversation because I know how words can hurt, because I've experienced those. And so I wanted to try and get the point across. Hey, kid, we can't do that. He knows that. But I also wanted him to know that We can grow in this. We can mature. We can find a way to move forward. And I didn't want to add to the heartache that he was already feeling. So James tells us that from the same mouth, blessing and cursing. Imagine that. We come here on a Sunday, and what do? We worship. Oh, God, you are good. We make that proclamation. And then we go, and we don't even make it to the restaurant before we start looking at others and speaking towards others with words that cut and hurt. And James is telling us, hey, it shouldn't be this way. A grapevine's not going to give you figs. It doesn't happen. A spring is only going to be fresh or salt. So out of us, as we mature, the things that we should experience coming from our tongue should be words that build instead of destroy. Now, here's the thing about tongues and words. The problem is maybe we should speak less. I mean, most guys don't have too much trouble not speaking too much. But then again, yeah, we do. I've gotten myself into trouble plenty of times by talking way too much. Scripture tells us often that we need to listen. James, in the first chapter, he goes, hey, be quick to what? Listen. And slow to what? Speak. Why is that? Because often our first response, if we don't even hear, we're listening to respond. Have you guys ever heard that phrase? Listening to respond. Because I have to say my piece and get the point across. Instead of listening to hear and understand. And so James tells us, this is before we get to the tongue portion. He's like, hey, listen. And we talked about last week, when we hear from God, it's often in the stillness. And if we're sitting here blabbering along, it's really hard to hear. Because words have the ability to build up or tear down. And as Christians, as we walk with the Lord, He's going to help form and shape us. And our opinions and our things we want to say should start to reflect that of God's heart. So when we look at God's creation, we should see their goodness. And if we see everybody as God's creation, we should feel a certain way about it, and we're not going to speak curses against it. It's hard not to, though. I always go back to the example of driving in a car. I'm the world's greatest driver. There's a bunch of idiots out there. Truly, like I have that mentality, and since I've been running, you know, going out the KBR, there's a bunch of little crosswalks you have to go in. And the other day I was coming up to one, and I was there a long time before. This guy's coming down the hill, doesn't break. I'm standing there looking at him going, really? The things that ran through my head, you dummy. Did you not see me right here? Who knows? I don't know what his circumstances were. But in my head, I was speaking curses towards this guy. You, I hope you get what's coming because you made me wait for 10 seconds. You know, it seems ridiculous. The tongue has the ability to cut deeply. I don't want you to reflect too hard on this, but for most of us, if we give it 30 seconds thought, we can think of exact moments where words were spoken. And we can still reflect. We can see those moments and go, oh, that hurt. I'll give you one example. I was a grade 10. I was in an honors class, an AP class that was combined English and history. Well, I started working. I had swimming at the time. It was just busy. And I was like, you know what? I'll just go into the regular honors class where I get honors history and English separate. And so I did that. And so I have 9 weeks left of school. And I go into this honors class, and this teacher, I would raise my hand to answer questions, and she would look at me and she'd go, let's hear what the honors dropout has to say. I was like, ouch. I asked her to not do that. Please don't do that. It happened multiple times over the course of the next couple weeks. Now, I'm 16 years old, and if you remember 16, you are very mature, and you know everything, and you do no wrong. And so finally, she did it again, and I walk up to her podium, and I said, I've asked you to stop calling me that. And I said, I'm going to go and tell my dad, and he's going to come rip you a new one. I told my teacher that at 16 years old. I walked out that door and went straight to my principal's office and told her exactly what I had done. I was reprimanded in a small way, but once they found out what had been said to me. But you know what? I still remember that. And I still look at that and go, oh, that hurts and it makes you angry and it cuts. And so this week, when you go and you participate in the life that God has led you in, think about the words that you speak. Maybe listen for a second, give it a beat before you respond and answer. Because that tongue is mighty. It really is awesome. I think James has a pretty negative view of the tongue. But I want to tell you, I think the tongue, the words that we speak, man, they can give life. But we have to be right in the heart before that overflows out. There's a proverb, I don't remember exactly where it is. I think it's like 9:24. It talks about kind words are as sweet as honeycomb. Think about that. Experiencing that, getting these kind words that lift you up. So church, this week, speak kind words. Build up. Don't find destruction. And if you do, ask for forgiveness. If you find yourself speaking with the poison tongue, if you find yourself speaking destructive things, repent. Not just before the Lord, but with the person. Say, I'm sorry. But remember, as we looked in Matthew, saying I'm sorry with no action, what does that mean? Nothing. This Max has probably seen that with his dad. Hey, let's play catch. Oh, yeah, we will someday. Oh, Max, I'm so sorry. And then the very next day, what happens to Max? He gets lied to and betrayed again. So if our words don't match our actions, they don't mean anything. So church, this week, go speak truth. Speak kindness, speak love, build up one another. But it's not just for us. It's amazing when James talks about that we bless the Lord and Father, and then we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. And then he says it ought not be so. The tongue is made to bless, to lift up. And I want you to know that it's not literally just the vocal. Maybe it's the typing. Did you know there's a new social media app out now? Instagram and Facebook came out with Threads, a Twitter-like. They've already got 90 million users. A new space where we can say whatever we want. So even online, even in your interactions, over that, we have to speak words that build. And I want to encourage you, because this is hard, if there is something in your life where words have been spoken to you that cut, and you've never resolved it, if you've never come to peace with it, if you've never offered forgiveness, go and offer forgiveness. Process it, because guess what? Resentment, it just eats at you. And if you're feeling that resentment and it's just boiling inside of you, guess what's going to well up out of you? So go find an opportunity to make amends. That doesn't mean things will be perfect, but it means you and the Lord can start to walk and move forward. So, church, I give you a challenge. Speak words that build this week. And if and when you speak words that destroy, rectify it. Ask for forgiveness. Repent. Say, I'm sorry, and put action behind it. Let us pray this morning. And then we'll sing this morning a closing song of Waymaker. Lord, I'm so grateful that you've made us these human beings, this image bearers of you. But with that, Lord, comes this power and responsibility to speak life-giving words. Or, Lord, we can also speak life-destroying words. So, Lord, I pray that as we go this week, that we will find the opportunity to be patient, to be still, to listen, to hear, and understand. So that, Lord, when we do speak, when we do respond, it's been processed. It's been through a filter so that we can be an example of you. That your love and spirit will well up in us and overflow out of all the things that we say. And Lord, I pray for each one of us that as we reflect and think about those words that we've had spoken to us, those ones that cut deep, the ones that have left wounds, Lord, I pray that you will help us process those. To find reconciliation in those, to find forgiveness in you, to go and just let go of the bitterness and resentment so that we won't be a part of a cycle of hurt people hurting people. Lord, it's only through your power that we can be life-giving people. And so, Lord, empower us this week as we go and we find ourselves in a variety of circumstances. May we be understanding. May we be patient. And Lord, most of all, may we be great witnesses for your grace and mercy. Lord, we leave all these things in your hands. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.